Geiser. I'm the pastor here at First Christian Church of Vinton. I'd like to welcome you to our virtual Ash Wednesday service. Due to a variety of factors, one of those being the pandemic, we are holding our service virtually and not in person this year. So again, we want to thank you for tuning in here to our YouTube channel and joining us in this manner. As we begin the season of Lent, we pray that the music and the message this evening will remind us of our sinfulness, our mortality, and help us deepen our walk with Christ. Let us pray. God our Father, as we begin this holy season of Lent, help us to see that your merciful love is with us always, even when we wander far from you. We ask you to change our hearts, that we might become better followers of your Son, Jesus. With the help of your grace, may our prayers and sacrifices, inward reflection, and outward service over the next 40 days lead us to welcome him in each other, in the poor, the sick, and the lonely, so that together we can greet him as one family at Easter. We pray this prayer to you, in Jesus' name. Amen. The Old Testament reading for the service is from the book of Joel, chapter 2. Blow the trumpet in Zion. Sound the alarm on my holy mountain. Let all the inhabitants of the land tremble, for the day of the Lord is coming near. It is near. A day of darkness and gloom. A day of clouds and thick darkness. Like blackness spread upon the mountains, a great and powerful army comes. Their like has never been from old, nor will be again after them in the ages to come. Yet even now, says the Lord, return to me with all your heart, with fasting, with weeping, and with mourning. Rend your hearts and not your clothing. Return to the Lord, your God, for he is gracious and merciful, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love, and relents from punishing. Who knows whether or not he will turn and relent and leave a blessing behind him? A grain offering and a drink offering for the Lord your God. Blow the trumpet in Zion. Sanctify a fast. Call a solemn assembly. Gather the people. Sanctify the congregation and assemble the aged. Gather the children, even infants at the breast. Let the bridegroom leave his room and the bride her canopy. Between the vestibule and the altar, let the priests, let the ministers of the Lord weep. Let them say, spare your people, O Lord, and do not make your heritage a mockery, a byword among the nations. Why should it be said among the peoples, where is their God? And this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. And now we'll share in the hymn, I Need Thee Every Hour. Psalm 103. The Lord is full of compassion and mercy, slow to anger, and of great kindness. He will not always accuse us, nor will he keep his anger forever. He has not dealt with us according to our sins, nor rewarded us according to our wickedness. For as the heavens are high above the earth, so is his mercy great upon those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far he has removed our sins from us. As a father cares for his children, so does the Lord care for those who fear him. For he himself knows whereof we are made. He remembers that we are only dust. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. And now we'll be blessed by the hymn, O Master, Let Me Walk With Thee. The epistle reading for our service comes from the book of 2 Corinthians. We entreat you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. For our sake he made him to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. As we work together with him, we urge you also not to accept the grace of God in vain. For he says, At an acceptable time I have listened to you, and on a day of salvation I have helped you. See, now is the acceptable time. See, now is the day of salvation. We are putting no obstacle in anyone's way, so that no fault may be found with our ministry. But as servants of God, we have commended ourselves in every way, through great endurance, in afflictions, hardships, calamities, beatings, imprisonments, riots, labors, sleepless nights, hunger, by purity, knowledge, patience, kindness, holiness of spirit, genuine love, truthful speech, and the power of God. With the weapons of righteousness for the right hand and for the left, in honor and dishonor, in ill repute and good repute. We are treated as impostors and yet are true, as unknown and yet as well known, as dying and see we are alive, as punished and yet not killed, as sorrowful yet always rejoicing, as poor yet making many rich, as having nothing and yet possessing everything. And this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The gospel reading for our service is taken from the book of Matthew chapter 6. Jesus said, Beware of practicing your piety before others in order to be seen by them, for you have no reward from your Father in heaven. So, whenever you give alms, do not sound a trumpet before you as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and in the streets, so that they may be praised by others. Truly I tell you, they have received their reward. But when you give alms, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, so that your alms may be done in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you. And whenever you pray, do not be like the hypocrites, for they love to stand and pray in the synagogues and at the street corners, so that they may be seen by others. Truly I tell you, they have received their reward. But whenever you pray, go into your room and shut the door, and pray to your Father who is in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you. And whenever you fast, do not look dismal like the hypocrites, for they disfigure their faces so as to show others that they are fasting. Truly I tell you, they have received their reward. But when you fast, put oil on your head and wash your face, so that your fasting may be seen not by others, but by your Father who is in secret. And your Father who sees in secret will reward you. Do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and rust doth consume, and where thieves break in and steal. But store up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust consumes, and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. One of the things that always strikes me about this day is that we begin the season of Lent by remembering the end. It's not, however, just any ending, a generic ending. It's your ending and my ending that mark the beginning of this new season, and that we remember this day. Remember that you are dust, and to dust you shall return. These words hinge between a dusty beginning in the book of Genesis chapter 2 that says, "Then the Lord God formed man from the dust of the ground," and a dusty ending later found also in Genesis chapter 2 reading, "By the sweat of your brow you will eat your food until you return to the ground, since from it you were taken, for dust you are, and to dust you shall return." Well, we can talk about our beginning and where it happened and when it happened and who was there. There are probably lots of pictures. But about our ending, when it will happen, where it will happen, how it will happen, who will be there, we don't know. None of us do. But I do know this. The reality of our ending is always before us. When I turned 50 a couple of years ago, I had a passing thought. It was that I'm probably closer to my ending than I am my beginning. It was one of those thoughts that got a hold of me and just wouldn't let go. Something in me was saying, remember, you are dust, and to dust you shall return. From the day we're born, there's a presence that accompanies us. It's our constant companion. It's invisible and yet ever-present. And regardless of who we are, what our station in life is, how big our bank account balance is, the square footage of our home, the make or model of the car that we drive, wherever we go, it goes with us. This companion, this presence, is called death. Today, we mark ourselves with ashes of mortality, a visible sign of our invisible companion. It'd be a mistake, however, to think that death comes only at the end of our physical life. Death meets us all along the road of life through various guises. It is in those moments when we experience the fragility, the uncertainty of our lives. Some level of fear is rooted in the fear of death. Death makes itself known through broken relationships, failures, shattered dreams, lost opportunities. Death will sometimes dress itself in our regrets or our disappointments. We recognize death's presence in those times when we betray ourselves and we live contrary to who we really are. If you've ever known grief, then you've gazed into the face of death. Every funeral that we attend, especially when it's for someone our age or even younger, it reminds us that everyone dies and that we too one day will die. I wonder if the specter of death is sometimes people's cause for stopping the celebrating of birthdays. We can try to forget or ignore or deny death, but no one will escape that final ending. Here's my question. What if escaping death is not the issue before us? I sometimes wonder if we've not only missed the point of Lent, but maybe even missed the point of the gospel. Maybe Lent and the gospel of Jesus are not primarily about being good a program from changing a bad person to a good person so we could get some future reward. Now, I've got nothing against being a good person, whatever that might mean, but what I have read is that Jesus said, "I came that they may have life and have it more abundantly," as we read in John chapter 10. Throughout the gospel, he shows himself to be giving life, revealing life to us, calling us to new life. And that's not about tomorrow after you die or some heavenly future, because Paul tells us now is the day of salvation. Now, in this time and in this place, life is now. And yet, how many of us grew up with the promise and hope of life after death and living forever? I did. It's what I wanted and still do. And for many of us, life after death was and maybe is still the central focus of our faith in Jesus. The older I get, the more I experience, the more urgent life before death becomes. Is there life in my relationships? Is my calling to the ministry full of life? Is there life in my friendships? Is there life in the way I'm living in this moment? Is there life in the way I see the world and relate to others? Am I growing? Am I bringing life to others? And is there life in me even as I stand before death? And if not, why not? What needs to change? What do I need to let go of? What needs to be done differently? Those just aren't questions for only me. Those are questions for all of us. What if life before death really is what Lent is all about? What if life before death really is what ashes of mortality are pointing us to? What does life before death mean and offer for you? Yes, life is defined, limited, and boundaried by death, but it isn't nullified by death. Death isn't a diminishment or a negation of life, but it is intensification. Mortality is what gives life its vitality. Think about it like this. Death is the frame around our picture of life. It holds before us what is. It focuses our attention. It intensifies, prioritizes what really matters. That this life we're living doesn't last forever doesn't diminish life's value. It gives it more value. The temporality of life means that this one moment right now is priceless. I often tell my congregation at the close of service, there will never be another moment in time just like this one. The question behind today's ashes is not whether you will die, what you will give up or do for Lent, or how to improve yourself, but the question is about your life before death. What do you want to do with your life? How do you want to live? Do you have life before death? The poet Mary Oliver captures this beautifully in her poem entitled When Death Comes. Listen. When it's over, I want to say, all my life, I was a bride married to amazement. I was the bridegroom taking the world into my arms. When it's over, I don't want to wonder if I made of my life something particular and real. I don't want to find myself sighing and frightened or full of argument. I don't want to end up simply having visited this world. Here again the words from our psalm earlier, "For he himself knows whereof we are made. He remembers that we are only dust." On Ash Wednesday, we mark the sign of the cross on our foreheads with ashes to show that we belong to Christ and represent our own grief and mourning for our sins, the same sins that Christ gave his life for when he died on the cross. As you join us there at home or wherever you may be right now, I will mark your forehead virtually. Remember that you are dust, and to dust you shall return. And now we'll enjoy the hymn, Wherever He Leads, I'll Go. In the Christian church, we practice what we call open communion, in that regardless of your denominational affiliation, we welcome all who put their faith and trust in Jesus Christ to God's table, for it is His table and not ours to deny. We praise you, Lord God, creator and sustainer of the universe. Grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, who on the night that he was betrayed, took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat, this is my body which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way and manner, after supper, he took the cup, and he gave you thanks, and gave it to them, saying, This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for the many for the remission of sins. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. Send down your Holy Spirit that these gifts of bread and wine may be for us the body and blood of Christ. Unite us with him forever and bring us with the whole creation to your eternal kingdom. The bread we break is a sharing in the body of Christ. And the cup we take is a sharing in the blood of Christ. Lord, we come to this table trusting in your mercy and not in any goodness of our own. We're not worthy even to gather up the crumbs under your table, but it is your nature to always have mercy, and on that we depend. So, feed us with the body and the blood of Jesus Christ, your Son, that we may forever live in him and he in us. Amen. Draw near with faith and receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which was given for you, and his blood, which was shed for you. Eat and drink in remembrance that he died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Amen. And now listen to the old hymn, "The Voice of God is Calling." In the footsteps of centuries of pilgrims, go now to embark on your Lenten journey. Consider how you may simplify your days so that you may travel lightly. Be alert to all that could sidetrack you. Notice that which beckons alluringly or with apparently greater urgency than the pilgrim journey that Christ invites us to. Do not try to cover more than one good day's journey at a time. Know when to stop for food and sleep, so that the journey will not be too great for you. Walk humbly, knowing that the goal is not recognition or achievement or reward, but simply to have come to know Christ and yourself more intimately. Be on the lookout for other pilgrims, caring for those who limp or fall, or those who just can't seem to see the way forward. The pilgrimage is always richer in community. Go now, place your hand into the outstretched hand of Christ. Allow the words of the story to guide you and pray for purity of heart and mind. Amen. God bless you. And again, thank you for joining us as we begin this Lenten journey together.